Hey everyone, so I'm back with another protocol on protein quantification by using different method, that is Bradford method. So in one of my previous video, I have discussed that how you can quantitatively determine the concentration of protein in a particular sample by using Lowry method. Yes, so there we have discussed the Folin-Lowry method, and in the very similar way we are going to discuss another protocol, that is Bradford method. Bradford method is specific for using a particular dye which is named as Kumasi Brilliant Blue G250. This dye is specifically used in this method. Bradford, the name was given by the scientist himself to the protocol. Okay, so we will be discussing the in detail principle, several points regarding the protocol, as well as the name of the scientist who have given certain statements regarding the protocol. Also, I will mention the reference so you can go back and look thoroughly through the points. Right, then I will give you a little idea about the current modified Kumasi Brilliant Blue dye. Okay, the modification we will discuss, then the requirement for the protocols, then finally we will discuss the protocol by using a reference. And at lastly, I'm going to tell you regarding the plotting of graph. Okay, so now we are going to start. So first, covering up the principle, the Bradford assay, it is a method of protein determination that simply involves the binding of the Kumasi Brilliant Blue G250 dye to the protein. Okay, this statement was himself given by Bradford in 1976. He simply stated that in this reaction there is binding of the dye with the proteins. Okay, there was simple binding of dye with the proteins. In this case, certain features of the dye give it a characteristic appearance at the end of the reaction. For example, in the second statement you can see Crompton and Jones in 1985, they found out that the dye, this Kumasi Brilliant Blue dye, exists in three different forms. The first one is cationic form, which is red in color. Okay, the second one is neutral form, which is green in color. And the third one is anionic form, which is blue in color. Means this single dye can give you three different appearance on the basis of the surrounding environment. Okay, for example, we will study it now. That for example, under acidic condition, the reaction is going to take place in acidic condition. So what happens under acidic condition, the dye is predominantly in double protonated form. Means if it is in protonated form, means the dye will show you red form, means the red cationic form, right? It is going to show you red cationic form, whose absorbance you can measure at 470 nm. Okay, it is the maximum absorbance, maximum wavelength for measuring the absorbance of this red form. Then, when the dye binds to the protein, means when there is a reaction between the protein as well as the dye, there is change in the form of the dye. What simply happens, there is unprotonation, means the protons which were added in acidic condition, now they are unprotonated. This unprotonated form is also stable, and now this form is blue form, which is anionic form, right? So previously it was cationic form, which is red color, whose absorbance can be measured at 470 nm, but now after the binding of protein to the dye, the form has shifted to the unprotonated anionic form, which is blue in color, and now you can simply measure the absorbance at 595 nm, means our final absorbance wavelength will be 595 nm. Okay, I have also mentioned the reference, and lastly, as I have mentioned, that the blue protein dye form that is detected at 595 nm in the assay using the spectrophotometer, means in our protocol we are finally concerned with the blue color, which indicates that there is successful binding of the protein with the dye. Okay, and finally we are going to take the absorbance at 595 nm, and we are going to estimate the concentration of protein in the sample. Okay, so in this sheet I have only discussed one thing, that is the binding of dye with the protein. Okay, I have discussed that the dye exists in three different form: positive, neutral as well as negative form. In acidic condition, the dye exists in positive cationic form, but after binding of the protein, it changes its form to negative blue color form due to unprotonation. Okay, this is a simple idea behind this reaction. Now, moving on next, you will see that while working with synthetic polyamino acids, if you are having synthetic polyamino acids in your laboratory, you can simply take those amino acids, polyamino acids, and you can treat it with the Chromacy Brilliant Blue dye. It was found that Compton and Jones, they found that majorly the amino acids which are involved in binding to the dye includes the basic amino acids, especially arginine. Okay, basic amino acids include lysine, arginine, histidine, right? And mostly there is involvement of arginine with the binding to the dye. Okay, so arginine can bind, lysine can bind, then histidine can also bind to the dye. Why? Because these are positively charged amino acid, and we know that the dye is going to change from its protonated form to unprotonated form. Okay, this unprotonation is mainly due to these three amino acids. Apart from that, certain aromatic amino acid residues can also contribute to the reaction in the unprotonation. Okay, there is going to be simple reactions which are going to exchange the charges on both the proteins as well as the dye, which causes the change in the form. Okay, I hope you are clear. Now, also I wanted to mention certain points behind the reaction, that majorly the van der Waal forces as well as the hydrophobic interactions influence the binding, because we know that the hydrophobicity plays an important role in proteins, right? So these interactions are also major part, as well as the van der Waal forces also contribute for the binding. Now, talking about the proportionality, the number of Chromacy dye molecules bound to each protein is approximately proportional to the number of positive charges found on the protein. And this positive charges on the protein means they are simply talking about the positively charged amino acids, right? Apart from that, one more important thing is, if you are treating free amino acids with the dye, there is not going to be any production of the any change in the color or any change in the form of the dye. Okay, so remember that free amino acids or peptides or low molecular weight proteins do not produce color with Chromacy dye reagents. It should be in peptide form, and the mass of the peptide or protein should range at least 3000 Dalton for quantification using with this reagent. Okay, most of the time when you extract protein sample from any biological source, for example plant or microorganisms, you are easily going to get above than this protein in your extract or crude sample. Okay, this method is highly sensitive. Okay, we are going to discuss the sensitivity as well. Okay, so now moving on next, we will be talking particularly about the Chromacy Brilliant Blue dye. Okay, so talking about the reaction between protein and the dye, you will see that while performing the protocol, it has been observed that there is certain interference by non-protein compound. Okay, the non-protein compounds causes the interference, and this interference is basically due to the ability to shift the equilibrium level of the dye among the three colored species. We have seen three forms, right? Red, green, and blue. Okay. The non-protein compound can shift the equilibrium of these three species, thereby interfering with the reaction, right? So certain interfering compound you should know while performing the protocol, that there are no, you can see here, there is list, for example, detergents, flavonoids, basic protein buffers, stabilize the green neutral dye species by directly binding or by shifting the pH. Means these interfering compound can stabilize the reaction and make it constant in the green form, means in the neutral form, right? Means in the uncharged form. And in this state, you cannot quantify the protein, right? This statement was again given by Compton and Jones in 1985, and further Penger in 1987 mentioned the statement. Okay, so now the first point we have discussed regarding the interfering compound, right? The second point is the reaction or the dye is also compatible with certain chemicals. For example, you can see that the Kumasi dye containing protein assays are compatible with most of the salts, solvents, buffers, thiols, reducing substances, metachelating agents encountered in protein sample. When you are specifically trying to extract the protein from any biological source, you are obviously going to use certain chemicals, right? You are going to use certain solvents, buffer, as well as reducing agents to extract the protein from the source, right? But these samples are not going to interfere with your reactions. Okay, so you can freely use these kinds of chemicals for extraction of protein. Okay, now we have seen two things. The first one was interfering components and the second one was non-interfering components. Okay, so later on, as I have talked about the interfering compound, later on Thermo Fisher, we all know about Thermo Fisher, right? Thermo Fisher Scientific. It is a company which is majorly involved in production of certain chemicals, right? We know about this big company. It is a big company, and on their website I have found that they have modified the reagent. Okay, they have modified the Bradford kit, which is compatible even to certain interfering substances. Okay, so I have mentioned the statement right here. If surfactants or if detergents or certain chemicals are interfering, then new formulation of the reagent, which they have named as Peer's Detergent Compatible Bradford Assay Kit, can overcome the issues. Means Thermo Fisher modified Bradford Assay Kit includes a modified Bradford reagent, which they have prepared by using certain additives. Okay, the Bradford reagent, which was modified by using certain additives, was found to be compatible with around, you can see its compatibility, with around 1% or higher of 11 known detergents, as well as lysis reagents that are commonly used in life scientific research, including Triton X100, NP40 detergent, and some of these issues. Solve these issues. Okay, it is overcome these issues. Okay, so what I'm talking about here is, now a reagent is available if you are using such kinds of detergent to carry out the lysis of the cell so that there can be easy extraction of the protein. So now you can use another Bradford reagent which is modified. Okay, and which is now easily available, so you can use it for performing the protocol. Okay, for example, this table I have taken from Thermo Fisher website. Okay, and they have three different Bradford reagent kit. Okay, you can see this is the Kumasi Plus Protein Assay kit. The second one is detergent compatible Bradford assay, and the third one is our simple Kumasi Bradford Protein Assay Kit. Okay, its formulation was given by Bradford in 1976. Okay, this was the original one. Later it was modified, and the modified detergent compatible kit is this, and this is also a modified kit. Okay, so talking directly, I will show you the third row. Okay, you can see the compatible reagents. The first reagent is compatible with buffer salts, metal ions, reducing agents, as well as chelators. The second detergent compatible is going to be compatible with detergent, buffer salts, metal ions, reducing agents, chelators, which means it includes all the interfering substances. Okay, the third one is simple. It simply includes buffer salts, metal ions, reducing agents, and chelators. Okay, so these are the three different kits that are available. Also, they have shown that with incompatibilities with detergent. The first one is incompatible with detergent. The third one is incompatible with detergent. The second one will be incompatible with detergent if the concentration is higher than 5%. It is better to use around 1% of detergent while working with biological sources or while working with the protein extract. Okay, the incubation time for performing the protocol is 10 minutes. Okay, and apart from that, they have mentioned their product details. Okay, so this was the thing I was talking about regarding the modification of the reagent. So you can visit the website or you can see in your laboratory whether this chemical is available or not. Okay, now moving on next. So basically this Bradford method is used when we are trying to extract protein from a plant source. Okay, and therefore due to high demand of overcoming these kind of interfering compounds, the reagent was modified. Okay, so you should remember the reason that why the reagent is modified. Okay, now we will be talking about the protocol. Now we are going to start the protocol. Okay, first we will be talking about the requirements, that is the equipment. You are going to require spectrophotometer to measure the absorbance, cuvettes you are going to require, then the reagents are Bradford reagent. Then the standard protein that we are going to use is bovine serum albumin. Okay, it is commonly used, bovine serum albumin reagent. Sorry, a standard of protein. Okay, then the glassware and other things that you are going to require, and also a distilled water that you are going to require for making up the solution. Okay, now along with this, the standard of protein we are taking to plot the standard graph. If you are having unknown sample, if you are having your own sample that you have extracted from a crude sample or a purified sample, you can take those. And for example, I'm writing here unknown sample. Okay, so we can also add it to the table. Okay, now talking about the dye, I want to give you a little information. This Kumasi dye, it is available in two different forms. The first one is R250 and the second one is G250. Talking about the chemical structure, both of these are disulfonated triphenyl methane. Disulfonated triphenyl methane. The only difference is that in the G250 form, there is extra two methyl groups. Okay, whereas the R250 form lack these two methyl groups. Okay, this is the only two difference. Okay, and also on the basis of color appearance, it is red tinted and the G250 form is green tinted. Okay, so these two forms are available. Now also talking about the sensitivity, the most important part behind every protocol is the sensitivity, that the protein concentration around 0.5 microgram per ml, sorry, per 100 ml can be quantified by using this method. Okay, so it is highly sensitive method. If you are having 0.5 microgram, even if you are having this much concentration of protein in your sample, you can quantify it with the Bradford method. Okay, now we will be talking. Okay, so now we are going to discuss the first protocol. Okay, in this case, we are taking the concentration of protein around 100 microgram per ml. Okay, so first, for example, you are having a stock solution of BSA, then you are having distilled water, then you are having a reagent. Okay, we are also going to measure the stock concentration in microgram per ml. I have taken microliter in one column and ml in one column to make it easy to understand. Okay, while calculating, it will be easy to calculate in microliter form. Okay, because the sensitivity of the method is very much high, so you can take even minimum microgram of protein for the quantification by this method. Okay, for example, now we are taking stock solution. I am taking 10 test tubes for creating the standard and one test tube for the test quantification. Okay, so for the test, the blank will contain no stock solution. Okay, so for example, the Addition will be like this: 0.1 ml, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, 0.5, 0.6, 0.7, 0.8, 0.9 and 1 ml. Okay, so to convert ml to microliter, we simply multiply ml by 1000 to get in microliter form. Okay, so if I multiply 0.1 by 1000, I will get 100, then here 200, 300, and similarly, finally, I will get here 1000. Right, you can either take microliter or you can either take ml. Okay, both are the same thing, the quantity will be same. Okay, now calculating the stock concentration, you can see here 1 ml of stock is having 100 microgram per liter per ml concentration, right? I have mentioned that 100 microgram is for 1 ml. So for 0.9, it will be 90, then 80, 70, 60, 50, 40, 30, 20, 10. Okay, so this is the way by which you can calculate the stock concentration of different test tubes. Okay, we are going to add distilled water by making up the volume to 1 ml. Okay, in this case, blank will be containing 1 ml, then second test tube will contain 0.9, then 0.8, 0.7, 0.6, similarly 1 ml. Okay, if you are having your test sample, you can take 1 ml of the test sample. Okay, the concentration is unknown. Okay, 1000 microliter will be its quantity. Okay, now after that, you will have to add 2.5 ml of the Bradford reagent, incubate it at room temperature for 10 minutes, and then you will have to take the absorbance at 595 nm. Okay, in this case, this is the first protocol. In this case, if the protein concentration is large enough, for example, it lies between 10 to 100 microgram, then you can follow this protocol. Okay, at that time you can follow this protocol. And if you are confused that your protein concentration is very much high in the sample, then you can even take 1000 microgram per ml of the stock. Okay, now if the protein concentration in your sample is very much less, okay, at that time you will use this protocol, okay, which I am going to tell you now. The concentration of stock is same, it is 100 microgram per ml. Okay, but now I am going to prepare 10 test tubes for standard and one for test. In this 10 standard test tube, I am going to take the stock solution in this form. Like the first tube will be containing 0.05 ml of the stock solution, then 0.1, then 0.15, 0.2, 0.25, 0.3, 0.35, 0.4, 0.45 and 0.5. These are the additions of the stock solution through the test tube. To make it easy, I will be converting it into microliter. Like 0.05 multiplied by 1000 will give you 50, then 100, then 150, 200, 250, 300, 350, 400, 450 and 500. Okay, the concentration, the stock concentration is same. If 1000 microgram is for 1 ml, then for 0.5 ml, the concentration will be half. Right, so you can calculate it in this way, that 50 will be here, then 45, 40, 35, 30, 25, 20, 15, 10, 5 and 0. Okay, you will have to add distilled water. Now I have mentioned it in microliter form to make up the volume to 0.5 ml or 500 microliter. Okay, so for 50 microliter, I will be adding 450 microliter of distilled water, then 400, then 350, then 300, then 450, sorry, 300, then 250, then 200, then 150, 100, then 50 and dash. You will have to take 0.5 ml of your test sample. The concentration is unknown. There is no need to add distilled water. And its volume will be 500 microliter. Okay, so in this case it is easy to understand in microliter form, therefore we are considering the microliter form. Okay, because the concentration is very much less. Okay, so you are going to use this protocol when you are confused that the concentration of protein in your sample is very much less. Means if it is ranging from around 5 to 50 microgram, then you can go with this protocol. Okay, same, you will have to add 0.2.5 ml of the reagent, incubate it, and then take the absorbance at 595 nm. Okay, I hope you are clear. Now, okay, so for the reference purpose, I have referred this paper. Okay, this is the reference I have taken. And in this case, you can see that the researchers have created a protocol and the concentration of protein they have selected was very much less. Means they have taken around 100 microgram per ml of stock concentration. And you can see here the test tubes. They have created these 10 test tubes for measuring the standard. And these are the test samples. Okay, whose concentration they wanted to quantify. Okay, the same table is here. You can see the volume of standard they have taken in microliter because it makes it easy to calculate, right? So you can see here in microliter they have taken 10 test tubes, the volume of distilled water, then the concentration of BSA. You can see here from 5 to 50. They have added the reagent, incubated it, and then they have taken the absorbance. Using this absorbance, they are going to plot the standard graph. Okay, in the very similar way, they have taken protein sample. You can see here, they have taken only 100 microliter of the protein sample. Okay, you can take 500 microliter as well, but in this case, they have taken 100 microliter of the protein sample, means how much? 0.1 ml. Okay, they have only taken 0.1 of the ml of the sample. They have make up the volume to 0.5 ml. Okay, the concentration was not known. They have performed the protocol and they have got the absorbance in this range. Okay, now if you see the difference between these two absorbance, for example, the first one and the second one, you can see the sample A test tube is giving you absorbance of around 0.052. It simply indicates that the concentration will be around 25 microgram per ml in the sample A. Similarly, in sample B, the absorbance is around 0.072, means it is going to range between these two values, means it is going to range between 40 to 45, right? Similarly, 0.021, it is going to range below 5, I think. Okay, it is going to range below 5 microgram. Then 0.086, it is going to range between 45 to 50 microgram. Okay, so in this way, you can have a little idea that what is the range of your concentration. Okay, what is the range of the protein concentration in the sample? But to get the accurate data, we depend on the plot. Okay, so we generally plot the graph and we carry out the calculation to get the concentration of the unknown. Okay, so I have already discussed in my previous video that how we calculate the, how we plot the graph, how we calculate the slope. Okay, so in this case, I'm going to give you a rough idea of calculation. Okay, so basically we take absorbance at 595 nm on y-axis. On x-axis, I'm going to take microgram per ml of stock concentration. Okay, for example, the concentration was like 0, 50, 100, 150, 200, 250, 300, 350, 400, 450, 500. Okay, and this was the absorbance plotted. Once you will plot the graph, you will get a straight line. Okay, the straight line points are taken from the standard absorbance. Okay, the points are taken from the standard samples. Okay, then after plotting the standard graph, we take the slope. Okay, for example, this formula of slope is y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1. You will get the value and you will have to use this value to calculate the unknown concentration. Okay, for example, unknown concentration is equal to OD by slope. Okay, for example, You have taken sample A, and the sample A has given you an absorbance of 0.052, right? So you will have to simply take the 0.052 value and you will have to divide it with the slope. The answer you will get is the concentration of protein in the sample A in microgram per ml form. Okay, so this is the basic idea. I will mention the link in the description box where you can go and see the video in detail that how to do this calculation. Okay, it is very easy. You will have to do only two calculations to get the concentration of the protein. Okay, so I hope you are clear with every point, every single point. Remember, the Bradford essay is mainly based on the features of the dye, the environment of the sample, means what are the chemicals present in the solution. Okay, it majorly affects the reaction. Okay, and then if you are having very low quantity of protein in your sample, so it is better to go with this protocol for quantifying the protein. Okay, it is highly sensitive method than Lowry method. Okay, if you have still any kind of doubt, you can mention it in the comments section. I will definitely try to answer your question. Okay, thank you so much for watching, and don't forget to like, share and subscribe. And lastly, I also want to mention that do follow us on our new Instagram channel, that is Learn Life Science. Okay, for regular updates on learning. Thank you so much for watching.